Hello and welcome to the NewsX Sunday Guardian Roundtable. Well, Prime Minister Modi has finally reshuffled his cabinet. This week, we are going to be discussing at the larger impact of this reshuffle and also this, the impact on this coming state elections. Has he done this with an eye on, say, UP, Gujarat, or does he have a larger deliverance plan in mind? Joining me on the roundtable is Ashok, Malik, political commentator and columnist. Virendra, Kapoor, also a commentator and columnist. Siddharth, Varadarajan, he is the founding editor of the Wire.in. Radhika, Ramaseshan, political editor for the Telegraph. Ashok, what is your large big takeaway from this reshuffle?
Well, there are two, three.
Apart from the sidelining of Smriti Irani.
Okay. I don't think it's all about UP or Gujarat in this coming state elections. I think that is one factor. But overall, I think the Narendra Modi government is focused on 2019 and on a possible re-election. So he has filled some gaps. He has also indicated that ministers who get into unnecessary controversies, even if they're otherwise useful, need to not get into those controversies, and they need to leave the politics and the rhetoric to him, because he is the face of the government, and just get down to work. And there are some key gaps which he has sought to fill, because MEA now needed a second minister with such a large portfolio and so much travel to be done by the cabinet minister and the ministers of state. HRD has a new minister, perhaps a more sober and business-like minister. Smriti Irani has her utility, but she did get into some controversies. Perhaps she'll be better suited for textiles. I'm very happy with the new environment minister, Anil Dave, not very well known in Delhi, but a very senior BJP politician. He's been an MP for some 6 years now, I think. He's a senior Madhya Pradesh politician, a very sober man with a background in the conservation movement and in the Narmada movement. So some good gaps have been filled.
I think you got to see it in two parts. What happened on Tuesday morning and what happened late in the evening. And then what happened in the evening is far more important. Your expansion, okay, you needed to, give some jobs to some MPs, aspirants for ministerships. But the reshuffle of portfolios is very significant. In the morning part, I think the party or the party chief played a major role with an eye on UP election, Gujarat election, Karnataka and all. I think the evening, it is a totally prime minister's job, the appraisal of the performance of every minister, and then he's moved them around. And very significant changes, as you said, Irani.
Yes.
I think she paid the price for being needlessly aggressive, taking on everybody, right, left and center. I'm told even including the PMO, continuing contentious attitude that she brings to her job. Whereas Prakash Jabdekar is a sober man, very persuasive, you will use tact. Smriti used always the sledgehammer, and she paid the price for this. Whereas as Jayant Sinha, I do think this is a good thing, because the senior minister is a good man, but not known for his drive or initiative. And you have a new civil aviation policy already on the anvil. Somebody has to take that sector ahead. Changes in INB, Jaitley had too much on his plate, and corporate affairs, finance. In fact, the injection of two ministers of state in the finance ministry will give it a rural, I like to think it will give it a rural emphasis, because both Jayant Sinha and Jaitley, all of a sudden, they are modern Western outlook, looking at the markets, whereas Meghwal and Gangwar, I'm sure that that was also needed. Overall, I do think that the imprint of the Prime Minister on the reshuffle is tremendous.
Siddharth, your take on this?
Well, I think it's a wasted opportunity. It's disappointing. Like Virendra, I think it's useful, I would say, to separate the expansion from the portfolio changes. The expansion is driven by the same logic as any prime minister of any party, who has to balance caste and regional considerations, and which is looking at elections. And I think it's significant that Uttar Pradesh and Gujarat have received a significant boost. I think this gives us some indication, not just about the importance of these two states for the BJP, but I think some sense that the BJP feels it needs to up its game. So I would say that there is a political significance which emerges from that. I have to say that when we looked at the record of the 19 inductees. All of them have been exemplary parliamentarians, with one or two exceptions. Their attendance rate, the questions that they've asked, their participation in debates. So these are unknown names because Delhi is a closed shop, and we tend to be better informed about, you know, EMTs, English medium types, and people who are visible in Delhi. So I wouldn't fault. I would say that these names are as good or bad as the existing ministers, as Manmohan Singh's ministers, and they're as known or unknown. I'll set that aside. The disappointing part of the reshuffle is the evening show.
Disappointing.
It is disappointing for the. Well, it's disappointing because it provided a glimpse into what was possible. So the Prime Minister, as they say, de raya durust hai, kam se kam, you know, after 2 years of controversy, he finally bites the bullet on Smriti Irani.
Correct.
After 2 years of putting up with poor performance of Mr. Sadanand Gowda, first in railways, then in law, he bites the bullet on that. But there are lots more people who are pulling this government down. Agriculture is a badly performing ministry. Health is a badly performing ministry. Skill development is lagging behind. Lots of junior MOSs. Their performance is nothing to speak of. More importantly, they have been defiant of the alleged diktat of the Prime Minister that people shouldn't speak out of turn.
Yes.
We are told that Jayant Sinha, one of the reasons why he was shunted out of finance was because his father has been speaking out of turn. Well, you have people in cabinet,
of
ministers. You have people in council of ministers, Giriraj Singh, Niranjan Jyoti, Sanjeev Balyan, Mahesh Sharma, who have been saying things that run counter to the government stated policy and position, right? The Prime Minister pretended in an interview that main unke chehre bhi nahi pehchanta. So if they are that insignificant to you, that you can't even recognize their faces, what are they doing in your cabinet? If you were bold enough to sack four people, eject them from your council ministers, I think one gentleman has gone to a party position, so he wasn't exactly ejected. And if you could relegate or demote Smriti Irani and Sadanand Gowda, why couldn't you act against some of these other people? It would have sent a great message. And insofar as you're worried about the messaging that's going out, Prime Minister himself in his interview to various papers said, he acknowledged that there is a perception media is gunning for him.
Yeah.
One of the reasons that they're gunning for you is because you have all this flotsam jetsam in your camp that you don't act against. Here was a great opportunity for you to act against them, and you didn't do that. So this is what is surprising and a little bit disappointing.
Why didn't he act against? Is it because of UP, Radhika?
No, if you're talking about Giriraj Singh, he's from Bihar. I mean, in contrary to expectations, the Bihar contingent stays exactly where it is, except for a bit of shuffling around of Ravi Shankar's portfolios. Not a single Bihar minister was dropped, although punished or dropped or whatever you call it. Although the expectation was that Bihar's representation would be curtailed after the disastrous showing in the assembly elections. Now, what I find also additionally interesting about the HRD changes is that the junior minister, Kathiria, was also dropped along with Smriti Irani. So it's like cleaning up the HRD ministry. And I would imagine it is also to minimize the Sangh's increasing interventions, increasing influence over the HRD ministry. Because the Vishwa Hindu Parishad, for instance, has been dying to get its nominees in the governing body of the Kendriya Vidyalaya
Sangathan. Smriti was not obliging.
So Smriti was obliging the RSS. She was not obliging. I mean, the BHP. Contrary. Yeah, she was RSS BHP. I mean, Smriti was trying to ingratiate herself with the Parivar in the hope that that would be a kind of sheath armor against her, against any kind of pressure on her from within the BJP. So there was a little bit of a cleaning up act, and I think this is also a signal from Modi to the Sangh that don't meddle over much. You know, this is governance. I shall do it the way I want. You know, but having said that, there are areas which are intriguing. For instance, parliamentary affairs. Okay, Venkaiah Naidu was not thought to be the best manager of parliament, contradictions and stuff like that in parliament. Now, how is Anand Kumar going to be an improvement? I mean, I foresee SS Aluwalia playing a far greater, far more active role in managing parliament and putting the nuts and bolts together than Anand Kumar. Anand Kumar is not really known for his PR skills, let's face it. Or the job will fall back on Arun Jaitley, who was sort of informally doing parliamentary management for the NDA government.
How do you read this parliamentary affairs portfolio and the influence of RSS?
Okay, parliamentary affairs has been a weakness in this government. Having said that, I don't know whether a change in minister alone will solve the problem, because the fundamental problem remains the lack of a conversation between the upper echelons of the BJP government, Mr. Modi, and Rahul Gandhi and Sonia Gandhi.
Yeah.
That, frankly, you can have the best parliamentary affairs minister, but that will not change. And whether the Congress will support GST in the Rajya Sabha or not is not dependent on the parliamentary affairs minister. That's another call which has been taken at a level well above his or her station. So I don't think parliamentary affairs minister in that sense is that significant. In terms of the Sangh, see, the Sangh is a very important stakeholder in the BJP and his government. It's not the only stakeholder. It certainly can demand certain policies or certain jobs or whatever, but there has to be an agenda which the government has autonomous of that as well. So you give jobs for the boys, but you also have a governance agenda. In terms of the governance agenda, perhaps the HRD ministry was a bit slow, because one of the issues this government came to power on was opening up higher education or increasing the supply of quality higher education institutions. You haven't had enough movement on that. On changing the regulatory framework of higher education, including, frankly, medical education, which is not under HRD. Revamping UGC, which is a half comatose organization. Mm. None of that has really happened. And that has nothing to do with the RSS, to be fair. That's more the ministry's own initiative.
You see, Smriti Irani was scrapping even with the PMO on changes. I mean, I was reading the other day, Indian Institute of Management, then you have to have 20 model institutions become, new. I mean, she's nitpicking when the officers dealing with education, the PMO and Smriti Irani were always at loggerheads. I think basically Smriti Irani, I have always maintained this, there is some inferiority complex in her which makes her so hostile. You say hello to her and she says, why are you saying hello to me? I don't know you.
The whole controversy about deer.
Yeah. I think that's the problem. Otherwise, she's in my view, she's fired up the party faithful. The way her regression and the way she responded in Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. But at the same time, it puts the backup of lots of other people. I mean, teachers were up in arms, student bodies were up in arms. You don't go around picking fights like a street fighter.
Okay.
Whereas Prakash Javadekar will be totally
concerned. Smriti Irani is a very talented politician. She's a great candidate. She's a great campaigner.
Of course.
Yeah.
The bet in 2014 was, especially after she gave Rahul Gandhi the great fight, which she may well beat him in 2019 in Amethi because she's focusing there. Huh. The bet was you'll build up another woman mass leader, which is a very valid bet. Perhaps HRD was a bit of a mismatch.
Yeah.
Maybe in textiles she'll do a better job.
But the one woman mass leader, Mr. Modi, as he doesn't use properly.
Yes.
Sushma ji is not keeping well.
Has grown.
No, but even before
her. Not keeping well.
But I'm saying the deployment of Sushma ji, I'm saying, yes, health is a recent factor, but she's invisible. She is not encouraged to, she gives one press conference a year.
No, she gets overshadowed by the
and
prime minister.
And now she's got MJ Akbar who's going to be
that's not right. That's not right. She has done a very good job. I'm saying that she is somebody that I feel this government is underutilizing.
Yes.
She should remain, as EAM. But I'm saying you need to have her more visible. She needs to be speaking out on foreign policy issues more often than what she's doing right now. And that's, I think, a deliberate decision that she has taken, perhaps in consultation with the Prime Minister. It's unfortunate.
Plus, I think the health is a factor.
That's a new factor.
And the fact that the Prime Minister, any Prime Minister, will overshadow the foreign minister.
Large canvas. When you have a highly competent and capable foreign minister her grasp of issues, the Prime Minister is looking at 101 things, right? And many of those things are actually going to be more decisive politically for his future in 2019 than foreign policy, quite frankly. When you have a fiercely competitive, fiercely competent minister like Sushma ji, it's surprising that she's not being deployed. I just think it's a waste of talent.
Now, what do you mean by deployed?
Deployed money, for example, on so many foreign policy controversies, like on NSG, why did the government take a back seat? I'm sure Sushma ji would have been...
Government didn't take a back. In fact, the criticism is that the government was very...
We can have a full thing on NSG, but I'm saying that I gave that as one example. There are lots of examples where
to the extent
there is confusion. There is confusion on
a whole host of Pakistan. You needed Sushma ji to go to Islamabad for the Heart of Asia conference.
Yeah.
So no, she did do very important things.
Her visits have been important and good. I'm just saying that the articulation of foreign policy needs to be done on a continuous basis. The foreign secretary doesn't do it. The prime minister can't do it. Somebody has to do it.
By and large, foreign ministers don't dominate internal domestic.
I don't know if MG Akbar will be empowered, but I think like Ashok, I think it's a wonderful thing that this government has finally decided to soup up the MEA. Mm-hmm. Because one, I would say you need three MOSs actually, because the range of, because you don't forget you have overseas Indian activities which has been merged, which is very demanding, and then you have unlimited protocol demands that have to do with the huge expansion of inbound and outbound, you know, high-level visits.
And MG Akbar will fill the bill.
Akbar will be fantastic there, without a doubt. I would say that's a positive thing, but I just feel that here's the articulation. I don't know how much Akbar will speak on foreign policy
how
matters when the minister herself is not speaking.
There, yeah. Are you pointing to a larger problem with this government, which has remained for 2 years of communication, which is a separate debate for another day, but I'm not limited to just the MEA.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
And let me suffice to say that.
And the Malays is the same.
Foreign ministers normally do not dominate the agenda or the news columns. Mm-hmm. So to that extent, Sushma is doing all right.
Okay. We just need to take a quick break. We're going to come back and I'm going to go back to Ashok to make his point. But just a fast, quick break. Welcome back to the NewsX Sunday Guardian Roundtable. Ashok, before the break, you wanted to come in and make a point. We were discussing Sushma Swaraj, whether she's being used properly.
I wanted to just switch the debate a bit from senior ministers to the MOSs.
Okay.
If you looked at the previous UPA government, many of the MOSs, very talented MOSs, had no work.
Yes.
This government is interesting in that the MOS cadre has a lot of work, some of them in independent charge, and the MOSs are really the backbone of this government. In a sense,
and
these
doing
are
a very good work. Such as Piyush Goyal.
Piyush Goyal, Dhamendra
Pradhan.
Yeah, but they've got independent charge. No.
Yeah, but still into MOS.
Also, MOS is working under, like, Jayant Sinha had a lot of work.
Yeah, Jayant Sinha had a lot of work.
Which is why his shift is strange.
Well, that's another matter. Maybe he'll have a lot of work in civil aviation as well.
I think civil aviation was a sleepy minister.
So, MOS, Kiran Riju has a lot of work.
He's got a lot of work.
These are the 50-somethings who have a stake in a post-2019 situation as well.
So he's grooming the next team, Modi.
The problem the BJP faced in May 2014, when you had, 165 out of 282 were first-time MPs, very little executive experience, he doesn't want that repeated for a future government, whether it's in 2019, 2024, whenever it is. He doesn't want that repeated. So there's a grooming process on, which is interesting.
Yeah, in fact, that was, Radhika, the problem with UPA, because I remember Milind Deora, Sachin Pilot, all these Jitin Prasad were brought in at the fag end of the government. That's what the whole main criticism was.
Even though they were brought in at the fag end, they're late than never, but I really don't know how much they contributed into decision-making, policy-making, and he's absolutely right. Here, I think Modi is very consciously grooming the next generation.
And he's clearly looking beyond 5 years.
Yeah, if you see the choice, P.P. Chaudhary or C.R. Chaudhary from Rajasthan, people may not have, the English media may not have heard of them, but they're all distinguished, qualified individuals. Mm-hmm. Anupriya Patel, I'm sure she's going to make a mark.
Is she going to be groomed for UP?
She could possibly be.
Maybe not 2017, but at some point in the future.
BJP's player will be from the BJP.
She has to merge.
Yeah.
But which brings me to Smriti Irani. Do you see, people are defending her, saying actually she will be deployed in UP. Do you see that happening? Or what use will she be?
I'm not sure. I think that if that were the strategy, a better way of doing it would have been to remove Mr. Kathiria, who was a dreadful Minister of State, and give her a proper MOS and have retained her in HRD. That was the strategy, right?
That's not.
I don't know, quite frankly, what the Prime Minister and Mr. Amit Shah have in mind. I think we will see Smriti Irani play a major role in the BJP's campaign. But I think that the fundamental question of whether to go with a CM candidate or not, what kind of, the caste strategy seems to have been firmed up by Mr. Amit Shah. But the big imponderable about what to do with Brahmins and upper caste voters in general is something that the BJP is going to take a call on. So I don't know, quite frankly. There is no question that now, 2 days later, Smriti Irani was moved because of unhappiness in the way in which she was running things at HRD. So there are no two views on that really anymore. But whether this is part of a master plan, I doubt it, quite frankly.
Her overreach in Uttar Pradesh was resented by Mr. Amit Shah.
Okay.
You know, she was getting increasingly interventionist in Uttar Pradesh. She was even harboring ambitions of contesting an assembly segment in Amethi. So she obviously had larger aspirations.
There is somebody tentatively that probably she can take Priyanka. But I don't think so. A wrong cast in a very caste dominant electorate. Plus outsider, Punjabi Khatri. But that's not the point. When you say deployed in UP, certainly she's an asset. I mean, there's no campaigner like her. I find that she'll give Priyanka Gandhi or whoever, Priyanka Badra, run for their money or Badra's money. But she's very aggressive, and on the pulpit, she'll win hands down.
I find this Delhi obsession of Priyanka Gandhi versus Smriti Irani in UP a bit overdone, because the real woman candidate there is Mayawati.
Absolutely. Okay.
She's the one to beat.
No, probably she can also take on Mayawati. Smriti
and Mayawati.
Yeah, why not?
Smriti Irani.
No, but they had a run-in in Rajya Sabha. Yeah. Smriti didn't come out to it.
Yeah.
Well, whatever. In UP is another matter. In Amethi in 2019, are certainly expected to take on Rahul Gandhi. But I think the UP election will not see her as, or any outsider as a candidate. Do remember in the 2014 Lok Sabha election, with the exception of Narendra Modi, every single, as far as I know, every single BJP candidate in the Lok Sabha from UP had a house or had rented premises or lived in his constituency. As in, he had a local address. Okay. He may be living in Delhi, but he had a local address as well. From everybody, as far as I remember. I think Modi was the only exception. If you follow that logic of picking up good local people, or people with a local commitment, then, and if you follow that and adopt that for the assembly election also, then you would look for a local face.
I'm not at all suggesting that Smriti Irani will be your chief ministerial candidate. No. All that I'm saying is she'll play a very important role as a campaigner.
She's a good campaigner.
Bringing Smriti Irani would be akin to sort of foisting Kiran Bedi on Delhi. I mean, the.
Hey, come on.
Kiran was the nominated candidate.
The BJP workers just kind of surrendered arms.
Okay, outsider factor.
Outsider. I'm not comparing the two, but I would mean on the outsider thing.
Back to inner party politics in Delhi. I, as an outsider, I'm a little intrigued by the message, the reshuffle, and some of the noise we've heard over the past 2 weeks sends to a senior person like Mr. Arun Jaitley. Because he has lost INB. What's the message there? Was he not doing a good job with INB? I've heard it said by people from the BJP spokespersons that Prime Minister wants him to concentrate on the economy. Does that mean that he wasn't concentrating on the economy? He's lost, by all accounts, a competent deputy, somebody that he had confidence in. And this loss comes at a time when he's also lost, or he's losing an RBI governor. He failed to protect him. This also comes at a time when a senior BJP MP like Subramanian Swamy could have a preemptive attack on Arvind Subramaniam and senior bureaucrats of the finance ministry and call Mr. Jaitley a waiter. And the Prime Minister had a veiled response in one of his televised interviews. If I was doing that interview, I would have actually asked Mr. Modi that if you're unhappy, have you communicated this to Swamy? Do you intend to communicate to Swamy? Don't you think a senior colleague like Mr. Jaitley deserves that public approbation, approval from you in this? That wasn't asked. He never gave that answer,
but
so we don't
Swamy
know.
But Swamy has kept quiet after that.
Well, he has, but I think public messaging is very important.
I think, you know, the people want to speculate whether Jaitley is down or up. It's totally irrelevant. It was not that INB was his substantive charge. It was not that defense ministry at one time. Was he cut to size when he lost defense? The fact is his substantive charge is finance ministry and corporate affairs, which he continues. And you, for God's sake, don't undermine the importance, the significance of finance. By itself, it needs full attention. And when you say Jayant Sinha is a competent minister and he's lost it, if you want to use your logic, that means Jaitley should be happy. One more man who doesn't know anything, these two guys. The point is that Jaitley works very well with Jayant Sinha because that's the way. And now you will see that these two ministers who come, they'll have freedom. but within the limitations of their own knowledge, their background, their experience.
No, but Santosh Gangwar is a very senior politician.
And he's worked in finance.
But he's a senior politician.
But he's won five times.
But there's a moral issue.
I know that. Labour minister.
There's a moral issue here because he was a minister in Vajpayee's government. He was MOS independent charge. Now he's just a regular MOS. So what signal are you sending him?
Probably that's the performance appraisal Modi did.
Yeah, so then you can't then say you're giving a competent person to Mr. Jaitley if that person is a demotee. Right?
But he's
so I'm saying that please look at the totality of the picture.
Like, you can say from a high profile HRD to textiles, but we don't seem to forget that textile is an equally important ministry. It may not be as high profile.
And there are also unofficial portfolios of Mr. Jaitley, whether it's parliamentary affairs, which he will be handling, which he does handle.
I've heard again, I'm just going by what official spokespersons have said. I think one of them on the channel that I was on said that the government needs to get its messaging right, and that's why you need a full-time INB minister. But we don't have a full-time. Mr. Venkaya Naidu Mr. Venkaya Naidu is going to be sharing portfolios, and Jaitley will still, I think, be the government's first line of defense.
But Jaitley's first preference was finance.
On media matters too, because Jaitley and Zavadekar. And Mr. Ravishankar Prasad to a lesser extent, but these are the three people who are most media friendly, media
But Siddharth, being a spokesperson and running the nuts and bolts in the IMD ministry, as you know, are separate.
Well, Rathore is running it anyway, de facto. And he'll continue.
Case, why have an IMD ministry in this?
I agree with you.
That's a very good note, but we're going to end on that. I think we all agree on that at least. But that's it from us. Thank you. Thank you for watching this edition of the Roundtable. We'll see you again same time next week.